Good evening, everyone. My name is Lauren Oldham, and I'm the regional manager for the Eastern and Midlands region with the CIOB. Thank you for joining us this evening. This session will be dealing around STEM and the STEM ambassador role. So how to get involved with STEM, how to sign up, ways that you can get involved once you sign up, or just to learn what is STEM. So we have with us here Craig Shaw. He's going to introduce himself later, so I'll let him do that. And also our member service and events coordinator, Sarah Chalmers, is also in the chat. So if you have any questions throughout the presentation, could you please just put them in the chat and we will get them to at the end. So I will hand over to Craig now, and at the end we will have an open session for Q&A. So thank you, everyone. And Craig, over to you.
Brilliant. Thank you, Lauren. Appreciate it. Okay, right. So, good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I just wanted to start very quickly just by letting you know who I am. So, my name's Craig Shaw. I'm Associate Director and Senior Building Surveyor at Academy Estate Consultants in Billericay, Essex. I primarily work within the education sector, dealing with schools, colleges, universities, on all manner of construction and mechanical electrical engineering projects. I am a Chartered Construction Manager and Chartered Building Surveyor. I am also Vice Chair for the CIOB Chelmsford Hub and a former committee member of the Novus, now known as the Tomorrow's Leaders. I am also a STEM ambassador, importantly, for today, since January 2022. So the purpose of today really is to give a broad overview on what STEM is, what it's about, and how you guys can get involved. So STEM, in a nutshell, refers to the science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, and how that's integrated within the education environment. It was first established as we know it today in terms of STEM in the early 2000s in this country. It is a widely accepted term on an international scale. Areas such as America and Australia also refer to STEM within their educational environments. So the purpose of STEM really is to get students thinking about these individual sort of four key areas: science, technology, engineering, and maths. And the purpose really is to develop skills in those areas relating to problem solving, creativity, critical analysis, teamwork, independent thinking, initiative, communication, and digital literacy. So why is STEM important? STEM subjects serve as a basis for providing a well-nurtured and future industry leaders in the, let's say, technology and engineering environments for us. STEM subjects provide foundations and the tools for future scientists, inventors, and engineers, and they're typically aimed at secondary schools. However, tools, workshops can be tailored for a much younger age as well, even right down to nursery age. So why are we doing this again? So STEM undertook a study back in 2016-17 time with regards to their impact. And you'll see on this slide here that there's a trend from people in terms of their interest in science right up to of an A-level age when they're taking their A-levels. Okay, and the difference in age between them, 10 to 11 and ages 18, and the gradual decline in terms of percentages, in terms of numbers of both boys, males and females, that are interested in STEM related subjects. Okay, so this highlighted a real need to get in there at a secondary school age to try and promote those subjects. So we've got people going on to, say, A-levels, colleges, universities that are going to continue within those subjects, but also make sure that at a younger age we're keeping these numbers as they currently are and where we would like them to be long term. As part of a 2012 survey, It was also identified that 82% of teachers think that they are lacking the necessary knowledge to properly advise young people. And one-fifth of parents also admitted that they believe that they are out of depth when it comes to talking to their offspring about career prospects. A further survey highlighted that nearly 53% of teachers do not feel they are confident about giving advice on apprenticeships. And in contrast, more than two-thirds said that they were quite confident of advising students about university study. So again, that shows the importance thereafter of STEM as an organisation of going into educational establishments to provide advice, workshops, give careers talks by people that are physically working within those industries rather than reliant upon the teachers themselves that may or may not have any previous experience within those industries or preconceived conceptions about what's involved, what their salary might be, and whether that's for them long term or not. So what has been the impact of STEM? So the STEM Impact Learning report for 2022 identified that STEM in its current form, and the ambassadors included, is supporting more than 2 million young people across the country. It's worked with every school within the UK and is connected with over 400,000 teachers and educators. It's linked STEM ambassadors from over 7,000 businesses to bring inspiration and industry knowledge to schools and educational establishments. And it's encouraged over 20,000 teachers to share their knowledge and resources within the STEM community. It's made over 14,000 resources available to teachers for free. So going back to what we were saying on the previous slide, again, it's enabling teachers to feel more confident, more competent in what advice they might be giving to their pupils on a day-to-day basis. So why are we talking about this today in the context of CIOB, and where does this fit within the CIOB? So as most of you will be aware now, that the new corporate plan was instigated this year, running until 2028, and it focuses on three key areas: quality and safety, environmental sustainability, and the skills gap. What we're interested in here with regards to STEM is more the addressment of the skills gap. So through the use of STEM and STEM Ambassador Programme, we're able to help introduce new talent to the industry through going in, undertaking talks with students, getting them curious and interested into how the industry works, help retain existing talent within the industry. And that might be the likes of yourselves by keeping you engaged, relevant and up to date on what's going on within the industry. To promote the industry on an equal, diverse and an inclusive manner, which I'm sure is something we all agree with. To establish new roles into the profession. So as the industry continues to grow and how we're looking at new technologies now and how they're going to be implemented within the industry and what future roles might come out of that. For example, a hot topic at the moment being AI and what future role AI will play within the construction industry and what roles will be created out of that. And lastly, to improve the perception of the industry. So it's very important that, again, where we may have teachers and people working within the education sector that may have these preconceived of construction as an industry and what's included within that, what your career prospects are, what you may be getting up to in future. It's important that, again, we have an opportunity to set the tone ourselves, being professionals that are working, studying currently within that industry, and set the tone for future. So for yourselves and how you could get involved, and I suppose the purpose of today really is to talk about the STEM Ambassador Programme. It's an opportunity for you to volunteer your time and to undertake individual talks, workshops, lessons, mock interviews, display models with your local community and educational establishments. The advantage for you getting involved and becoming a volunteer, it provides you with a sense of purpose. It gives you a sense of local community. It gives you an opportunity to work with local schools to you. You get the opportunity to choose how far broader net you cast from with regards to where you're either based professionally or personally, where you live. It's an opportunity for you to help build a network, for you to increase your social skills, improve your self-esteem, getting out and about, getting face-to-face with people, as well as improving your technology skills using presentational skills such as this with regards to Microsoft, as well as use of Teams and presenting digitally, teaching you valuable skills. More importantly, it's on your own terms, so you can choose how much time you're giving to this, as long as you're meeting the minimum requirements that STEM require of you, which we'll come on to shortly. You can decide what events you get involved with and what suits you in your timetable. Commercial advantages. So for some people, likes of myself that work within the educational sector, it's an opportunity for me, yes, to give back to the local community and to schools. But from a commercial perspective, it's also an opportunity for me to go out there and make important relationships with potential clients moving forward. And that might be something also that your employers might think of you in future if you was undertaking this function. So the impact on employers. So it makes a positive impact on the corporate social responsibility targets of your organisation. That could relate, again, that right down to social value for some of your contracting partners. It provides more motivated employees, an increase in communication and presentation skills, improve local recruitment, again, by making local education schools, colleges aware of your existence and then the potential for you to obtain new talent as a result of that. And as I mentioned before, with regards to the commercial awareness, there's a positive brand in representation and awareness if you are getting involved with this, which I'm sure your employers will appreciate. So how to become a STEM ambassador? Firstly, what you'll need to do is you'll go onto the STEM Learning website and complete a short online application form and register an account with them. Your application will then be reviewed by the administrative team, okay, and you'll receive an email confirmation back. You will then be invited to complete an online induction training course at your own pace. From memory, it really does depend on how much sort of time you're willing to commit on getting that done. But realistically, you're talking a few hours here, especially if you're looking to undertake it one evening in one go or over a weekend. But the important thing here is, again, it's very much at your own pace until you're happy and you've got time to complete that. Once that induction training is completed, you'll need to complete a free enhanced DBS application if you're not already in receipt of an enhanced DBS. You will then need to submit a digital copy of personal ID. So it's normally a scan of a passport or driver's license that's sent across to the STEM team. With all of that being acceptable, you'll then receive confirmation back via email of your acceptance as a STEM ambassador, and you'll receive your ID card. Thereafter, once you've received that ID card and your acceptance, on the online dashboard, which is via the STEM Learning website, you'll be able to set your individual preferences and your public profile, and that will determine what kind of level of engagement you're willing to accept, insofar as are you willing to work with children of all ages, whether we're talking nursery, primary school age, or whether you're specifically focused on secondary schools. And your preferences might be something, for example, where you work, you might be willing to go up to a distance of 100 miles from your place of work, for example. So it enables STEM to then be able to filter what opportunities they put in front of you for you to then say yes or no. It's important to remember, though, that that is easily adjustable at any point in time should your needs change or should your location change. So it's very easily adjusted. Your public profile, I'd say, is quite important. And the reason I say that is because when you offer your services, whether you, you're setting up something, an offering, which we'll come onto shortly for yourself, or whether you are looking to apply to join a pre-existing workshop or mock interview, those educational establishments, that is what they get to see of you, your public profile. So it's effectively a representation of you, what you currently do, what's your experience, and what you have to offer them as an establishment. And it's on the basis of whether they say yes or no to you, I suppose, as an individual on that basis. What I would say is most of the time from experience is they're more than happy just to have you put your name forward and volunteer your time to help out. Okay, so once that's done, you'll be able to start volunteering. So next, as I said before, is the search for the activities. So how you find in these opportunities. With the online dashboard that you'll have access to, you'll have two options. So with those preferences that you've set before, you'll see on this slide, you can set distances from certain locations, for example, and then it will filter what's currently available and what you can choose to get involved with, okay? And essentially what date, when they're being held as well, okay? And that's for browsing for pre-existing activities. You do also have an opportunity to put what's called an offer out, and that might be something that you, for example, have come up with a really good idea for a learning activity that you'd like to deliver to a specific demographic, a specific age, that you want to put out there for someone to essentially take you up on that offer. Okay. And again, they seem to be increasingly popular at the moment because STEM and the activities associated with STEM is greatly increasing year on year. You can also use your own professional and personal networks. So I, for example, historically have had friends that work within schools that know of my existence as a STEM ambassador and previous involvements within careers fairs, for example, and they've asked me specifically to come in. So it's about being aware that just because it's not on the STEM website does not mean that it cannot be applicable to this as a scenario. Okay. And if you do decide to do anything that's not specifically linked to STEM on their website as an activity or as an offering, doesn't mean that you cannot do it. As long as there is active learning involved there within an educational establishment, you can log that thereafter. Okay. And not to mention professional institutions. So you might, after this, you might get a reach out from whether it be an MSEC, whether it might be Lauren, for example, someone employed directly by the CIOB or another professional institution. They might email and say, we've got this come available. This school's reached out to us. Would you be interested in undertaking this function? Okay. So what is expected of me or yourselves as potential STEM ambassadors? So the minimum requirement to retain your ambassador role is each year you must complete a minimum of one activity. Okay, that activity, any activities must be logged on the portal. Okay, and we'll come onto that shortly. But for a minimum of one activity, I'd say actually it's really easy and it's really worthwhile completing and maintaining your ambassador stance. So STEM also expects you to treat others with respect, uphold the values and reputation of the STEM ambassador program. Okay, so to not put it in disrepute. So I think that'd be the exact same for you working on behalf of the CIOB anyway, and it's exactly what I think would be expected of you as individuals and as professionals within the industry. And to contact your local STEM hub if you need support and advice, and we'll come on to support and advice more so towards the end, but it's a good idea to remember that there is a local STEM hub that would be available. So for me, based in Essex, my local one is actually Canterbury in Kent, but if you have any problems, you can reach out to them. They're more local geographically and they'll be able to offer some regional advice to you where needed. So to do your best to fulfil the volunteering commitments and provide as much notice as possible if you can no longer attend. I think we'll all agree again that that's a relatively straightforward one, and it's common courtesy that if personal circumstances will change, and sometimes, unfortunately, you will just physically not be able to make appointments and that have been pre-registered and organised. However, it's just about how you as a professional, again, act in that manner when that arises and making sure that we're not letting people down unnecessarily. To record your activities, so again, we'll come onto that very shortly, but any activities that you do undertake, it's important that it's logged and registered, because it enables the STEM community and the staff behind the scenes to monitor their impact and how many people they're reaching out to. So when I discussed earlier the STEM impact report for 2022, all of that data is collated based upon what the individual STEM ambassadors are logging within their dashboards and their SharePoints. Okay, so it's incredibly important. Lastly, but not least, to adhere to STEM policies, and this again includes the safeguarding and data protection, which is something that's run through, I can say firsthand, on the induction training in quite some detail anyway. And I would say there's nothing again there that you would not normally expect of you working within the likes of a school or college or any educational establishment. Okay, so logging your activity. I've taken some screenshots here from my own dashboard and what's required to log the activity. So it's relatively brief, straightforward and quick. It's not too onerous. We're talking here about the activity name. Okay, so what the type of activity did you participate in? So whether it was a workshop, whether it was a talk, a presentation, a careers fair, any hands-on sort of elements to that, okay, as well. So there's quite a few, a very popular one at the moment, more so with the nursery age and the primary school age, is actually building Lego structures. And that seems to be a very popular one for construction in the built environment. And there's certain tasks that can be implemented around that to give it some structure. So to provide a bit of detail about your activity, okay, so types of things that you did and the people that were participating. When and where did this activity take place? Okay, was schools or organisations participated within? Date of activity, how long was the activity? How long did it take for you to prepare for the activity, as well as the audience? So again, the age, the number of expected participants, and who was actually physically there with you. Okay, and then right at the end is add this activity, and that's it. That's that logged. That's all you need to do. Okay, so I think we'd agree there that it's really a total of 5-10 minutes if you've already carried out that activity beforehand. It's important to remember that there is a wide range of activities and things that you can do, and I think they depend upon what you'd be looking at and what you'd feel comfortable at undertaking, and as well as the age group that you're targeting as well. Some people may feel more comfortable delivering workshops and talks for the likes of secondary school ages. I personally feel much more comfortable doing some of the year 10, 11 stuff with regards to mock interviews and careers fairs, reviewing CVs, as well as giving industry talks as well. So just talking a little bit about my role, what my career progression has been within the industry and what opportunities that's thrown my way. I'd say both as an employee within the industry, but also with regards to my professional affiliations to the CIOB. Okay, so I've listed a couple there, but it's important to remember that there are absolutely hundreds out there, and you can find details of specific challenges and structured learning on the STEM website, as well as other various learning resources. And I've actually found that YouTube is a very useful source of knowledge for putting some of these activities together as well. So it's important to remember that you guys stay safe when you're undertaking this function, okay? Online induction training contains all information that you're required with regards to health and safety and your role as a STEM ambassador. I've included a few short tips here today with, well, tips and hints with regards to risk assessments and making you aware that you are insured whilst undertaking these activities. But what I really want to stress is that you should not, under any circumstance, be left alone with any children whilst you're undertaking these functions. And it's important that that information is relayed back to the educational establishments you're working with, most of which have worked with the likes of STEM before, but where some of you might be undertaking your own individual pre-organised talks, functions, workshops, etc. And it's important to make sure that that is relayed back to them, and that moreover, you are conscious that you're abiding by that individual school's safeguarding policy and privacy policy. And that ties in with photography and the use of cameras, photographs, pictures being taken, videos being recorded around around young children. Training and support. There are many tools out there online. The ones that I've found most useful personally is the STEM Learning website itself. There's also an app that you can download. So it's a handheld device. It's really easy to use out and about. It enables you to search for functions and things on the go as well, rather than sitting down in front of a computer. The local STEM hub, which I'd mentioned before, enabling you to reach out, seek advice on specific circumstances, something you may be thinking of undertaking in future in terms of an activity that you want to run past the local community. They'll be able to give you advice and even maybe tips and hints on things that have worked well in the past for them as well. Once you can complete your STEM induction training, you'll also be issued the STEM Ambassador Handbook, which again has loads of tips and tricks within there and things for you to refresh your memory on at a later date. There is a monthly STEM update email that gets circulated to everyone, and that gives you an idea of what's happening in the wider STEM community. As I mentioned before, YouTube is a brilliant source of information for STEM and for the activities that you can put on. There's plenty of how-to guides in there and advice on how best to engage and support children with their learning, and how you can also measure the feedback and what the outcomes are of the activities that you're undertaking. Social media, so LinkedIn, very valuable resource. I've spoken about this several times before. But I believe also that STEM also are available on other social media platforms such as Instagram, I believe, and Facebook. I'm not sure if they're on TikTok, but it's worth looking at. And last but not least, keeping it all CIOB related, the CIOB staff and the MSECs. So there's, if you ever need any advice or support, whether they're able to answer any questions then and there, they'll certainly be able to go away, find the information and come back to you thereafter with any answers that you guys need. Okay. So I think I finished a little bit ahead of time today. Just want to thank you guys for your time and just open up if there's any questions at all that I can answer that have been put in the chat. Lauren, has there been anything sent through?
Not that I see, Craig, but if anyone has any questions there, you can come on camera, come on mic. If you don't have any questions and you think of something later and you think, oh, I wish I would have asked that, please just email either myself or Sarah. I'll put the emails in the chat, but oh, we do have a question. So we have Dean Allen. Dean, do you want to come on mic?
Hello. Okay.
Hello.
Hi, Dean.
Hello. I've undertaken the induction and I'm actually registered as a STEM ambassador. Did my first event on Monday and I've had another one today. My question is with regards to the ID card and handbooks and several other things that you've mentioned. I've not received any of these particular items. How would I sort of follow that up? Because it is something that I'm pursuing. It is something that I want to be actively involved in. Yeah. But I don't know whether it'd be through the original portal that I first registered, whether they're the people that I need to sort of chase on it.
Good question, Dean. I think this is one for the CIV staff, Greg. So if you're happy to, I can send you an email and link you up with the respective team with the CIOB and try to figure out what happened there. But yes, if that's okay, if I can just email you and try to figure out what we can do there.
Sorry, Lauren, I'd also add to that for Dean in the meantime as well. It'd probably be worthwhile for you just reaching out to that that local hub again. I don't know if on your welcome email they specifically identified that for you. I believe from memory, when you log into your dashboard, you're able to, I believe it comes up or you're able to search who your local hub is for STEM specifically, and it should have some relevant contact information on there. I believe it's normally just a generic email address, but definitely worthwhile, Dean, just reaching out to them to begin with and just asking for that information.
Okay, thank you. I mean, it was something that my employers actually encouraged me to do, but it's something that I also want to continue through the CIOB if possible. So I think it was Go Construct STEM that I was sort of registered with.
Okay.
Dean, do you want to just give us a little bit of your experience on your first STEM encounter? Do you want to tell us what you did?
Yeah, it was the LEBC that reached out to me to ask if I'd be interested in attending a school, and the event was called What's My Job? Which was very interesting because I'm a senior quantity surveyor, and children of that age, I wouldn't generally expect them to understand what the role is and what I do. So it was, I went around three different classrooms and spent 20 minutes in each class, and the children were asking questions and I could only answer yes or no. But we kind of got to a point where we hit a flat spot, and I had to kind of steer them towards the industry, and because I was everything from a security guard to an airplane pilot. So yeah, it was quite an interesting experience, and it really does show that there's a lack of basic knowledge at that sort of age in terms of the industry and the careers available. So it's definitely a reason why I want to be involved, because I didn't come from construction originally. I was from a manufacturing background, so I came into it sort of later on, in my mid-30s. So now I've kind of got to a point in my career where I want to sort of reach out and highlight the opportunities that are available to young people, rather than make the same mistakes that I did early on in my career. If that makes sense.
No, definitely. I agree, Dean, and I'm very similar to that regard. I believe personally, I feel very fortunate to be in the position that I'm in, and it's about giving back now to that next generation, trying to, for me, to be the person that I suppose I wanted when I was that age, that guidance. And yeah, whether sort of corrupt constructions for you or not long term, that's up to you as an individual, but at least giving people some realistic advice and manage expectations and just simply make them aware of our existence. You know, people commonly think construction is purely digging footings, plumbing, electrical, laying bricks, and there's so much more to it than that, and it's important that the likes of yourself are reaching out and making people, young people, aware of what opportunities there are available.
Today's event was an interesting one, because it was a group of students that had been involved in a workshop, which is like a week-long work experience project where they're building a road. And my employers asked if I'd be interested in talking a little bit about my career and the paths to sort of get to there. And I think it was about half an hour chat. It was my first online presentation as well, and I've never used Zoom, so there's a couple of hiccups along the way, but it was again an interesting thing to be involved in, so that it was good that somebody's actually taken the time to say, right, okay, here's a situation, what would you do in this situation to these young people, and to highlight some of the areas in the industry that, you know, you could potentially be involved. So from the inception to, you know, completion, it was nice to be part of that. And there was also a health and safety person doing a talk, and a bid writer, and it was a good thing to be involved in. So I think these kind of things are quite important to sort of tackle early on, whether that's, you know, sort of primary, secondary, or even higher education. You're not always aware of the paths that you can take and the options that are available to you. So it was a very good experience.
Any other questions, Lauren?
Don't see any hands up at the moment, and nothing was put in the chat. Oh, sorry. Dimple has a question. May I know the information on the name of the app?
Oh, geez, now you're asking. I believe it's STEM Community, the app is called. I'd have to just double check, but I'm fairly confident it's STEM Community. I'll make sure after I make note of that, and I'll just confirm it with, I'm guessing this presentation is going to be made available, isn't it, Lauren? So
yes, it is.
So I'll make sure that's included within that as well.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Thank you for the question as well. Anybody else have any questions? And apologies to you, Dean. I thought that you had signed up through CIOB, but I can see that you hadn't. So I do apologize for the confusion. So any other questions in the chat? If not, like I mentioned, I just popped my email and Sarah's email in the chat. And if you have any other questions, we can either forward it to Craig or get you in touch with Craig, because he's quite brilliant in this aspect. So thank you so much, Craig, for your time today, for everything, and for the attendees for joining us. We hope you found it very informative and useful. And we are always here should you have any questions. So it just doesn't end tonight. So if you have any questions, please reach out. And thank you, Sarah, as well, for putting this together. So I hope everyone has a great evening.